The following is a conversation with Alexandra Weilenmann, professor and head of the Division of Human-Computer Interaction at the University of Gothenburg. She investigates the use of mobile computing technologies and how they integrate into our everyday lives, primarily through ethnographic work, where she and her colleagues place themselves as close as possible to their subjects. Her research has covered how mobile computing figures in the experiences of hunters, journalists, airport personnel, drivers, museum visitors, teenagers, and the elderly. This was recorded to support our teaching in the master's program on interaction design and technologies at Chalmers University of Technology and the University of Gothenburg. If you find these discussions interesting, you should subscribe to this channel and follow me on Twitter at Dr. Bytosh, where I continue to cover topics in design, innovation, computer science, and more. Our conversation with Alexandra Weilenmann is presented in two parts. Part one was an overview of her research. This is part two, where we drill down into specific learnings, tactics, and debates that are relevant to her work. That was a very interesting presentation. I actually have so many questions for you. First of all, I noticed that you do a lot of ethnography. That is a research approach or method that you use very frequently. I'm curious how you define ethnography. In my perception, in my understanding, ethnography denotes a very sort of sophisticated tradition and a very rigorous way of conducting field research, writing and reporting on it. And when you do not do those things, when you're not fully engaged in the tradition of ethnography with its roots in anthropology and sociology, then I feel like you're not doing justice to the word. And that's why when I teach it, I call it observation. How do you feel about these distinctions, you know, between ethnography and observation, and also between ethnography or observation and interviews and participation? Because in practice, they sometimes jumble together, right?
It's a good question. I guess I don't worry too much about it myself, but I understand that as a student, I did worry about it as well. I mean, the term, of course, as I showed you the pictures when we started out, it has a long, very long tradition. And of course, some people can think that you can be a bit sort of clumsy if you just come in and sort of, you know, you just pull some things out, some things you like, and then go and do something really quickly. There, I'm sure you've heard of the concept of quick and dirty ethnography, a term that shows, has a connotation that this isn't really done the right way, that it should be done. There's an important distinction that you're saying, like, is it ethnography or observation? Should we call it observation? You know, ethnography can be many things, not just about doing observations. It could also be like an ethnographic interview or, you know, it doesn't really equal only observation. And I think it's sort of a mindset in a way. Even if you don't have time to read all these things and you don't have time to conduct work for a very long time, you can still bring with you sort of a mindset of trying to put yourself in the shoes of these people that you are even talking with or interviewing or whatever. Barry Brown talked a lot about this in his lecture as well, I know. So, but it's really about trying to see, you know, what's relevant for the people that I'm studying. Mm-hmm. So you can sort of have, I think you can still have sort of an ethnographic perspective in a sense, even if you're doing a study for a shorter time.
Actually, the next part of my question was going to be what you would recommend when doing ethnographic research or field research in shorter timescales. If you only have days or weeks or maybe a couple of months to do an entire design project where you want to involve ethnographic research, what would be the considerations as opposed to a full-blown research project which takes many months?
Don't start with asking people. So don't start with the interview. Particularly, I know among students, it's very popular to start with doing a questionnaire, because it seems to be quite a relatively easy way to get some data in a quick way. Whereas I would suggest to instead start to trying to identify a situation where something is used or a situation where you would introduce a technology, and then sit back and sort of observe. Yeah, in much the same way as they were doing in the movie that I recommend, it's Kitchen Stories. You know, sit back and sort of, okay, what's going on here? And I think that with my students, I've done this in many different sort of setups, and we've had sometimes very short time span to do it. But you can still learn, I mean, from just going out for one day and sitting in a cafe or sitting at this museum or whatever, you can still sort of learn some things about, okay, so what's going on in this environment? You know, what are the key places? What are the trajectories within this space? What sort of tools are they using, like both technologies and sort of other types of tools and artifacts? So you can sort of bring this ethnographic mindset, I think, with you, even if you don't have all that time. And what happens then with many students is that they get very frustrated because they think it's very efficient. So it's like, you sit here, I've been sitting here for several hours and I don't really have anything to write, or I don't have anything to say. It has to be much quicker. And they also want to ask questions. So they sit there and it's like, oh, what? I don't get anything out. I'm just sitting here looking at people. You know, I want to go up and ask them, why did you do that? It's always this why question. So we should not start with a why question. Why are people doing this? We should start with how are people doing these things? And this is something that we can observe. And of course, like every sort of method has, you know, some sort of historical background and a lot of things you can read and things you should know. So even when you're doing interviews, you can do really crappy interviews that you can't really get anything out of them, or you're really sort of steering people into what you want them to say. But it's still something that everyone, you know, everyone has an understanding. Someone, I think it was David Silverman, who said that we live in an interview society. You know, the interview is like the first thing that we think of, like our go-to research method. Where I want to really suggest that don't start with talking with people about why they're doing things. Like step back and see, okay, how are they doing things?
It's really good to hear this from you, because this is what I actually recommend to my students. I do teach interviews and also observation as research approaches, but I always tell them, you know, don't start with the interview. Go and sit somewhere and have a look and take notes. Yeah. And I have a few resources that I particularly benefited from when I was learning these methods that I give to them. And I say, you know, just read this and go do it. But it's also good to explain things in speech, in words. And thank you for doing that so efficiently for me and corroborating some of those things that I've been trying to teach. So you mentioned you start with the observation, but then you might feel the need to also ask questions to people. So is it somehow methodologically inappropriate to just get up and go and ask that question, to mix these two approaches in the moment? Or is there some other reason why we should avoid this? Or should we maybe not avoid this and go and ask the question in that moment?
I guess it depends on you know, what the research question is, and of course how we design our study. Going back and forth, I think it's quite natural. Yeah. In a way, it's like learning to do something. I mean, if you're new at work, you would combine sort of by looking at what people are doing, and then you would ask if you don't understand, and then maybe you would read some documents sort of that describes like the procedure, and then you would, you know. So I think it's very similar in many ways to sort of learning, you know, what do these people need to know? What would I need to know and able to do these things the way that they do? But many times I think people are, if you're a bit new at this, you get a bit nervous. So you think that you need to move ahead and start asking things. Depending on what setting and what people are you are observing, what type of activities, you can also just socialize a bit with people, because then they get more comfortable and they will start telling you stories and narratives that will give you some more information.
Is there a particular book or other resource that you would recommend to learn ethnography and other related research approaches and methods and considerations?
Lots of books, of course, that I have read that I have sort of borrowed pieces from. If you are a beginner student, I think that David Silverman has a few books that are very useful. Doing qualitative research, And he has also done, if you're a bit more hardcore, he has also done a book. David Silverman has written a book about Harvey Sacks and conversation analysis, which is a very good read, I think, to understand how sort of things are connected. I was inspired when I started by reading Lucy Suchman's work. I know a lot of people cite it, so maybe they haven't read it, but I think reading that, if you want to start with something, and also then looking into how she sort of brought that type of perspective into the technology domain, would be very useful if you have some extra time to do that. But otherwise, like, David Silverman has really great introductions, I think.
I'm laughing because I have cited Lucy Suchman's books, and I have one of them in the bookcase behind me, and I haven't read it yet. So that's really great. That should be beneficial to a lot of us. When you were explaining about how you studied the evolution of mobile devices, how smartphones changed their shape, and how the use cases for smartphones also evolved in time, you mentioned that they were first marketed as tools for work. They, in time, turned into tools for leisure. We now, like, I think now the most popular applications on smartphones are social media. We use them to look at, you know, pictures, kill time, keep in touch with people, mostly for fun, but not for work. No one that I know enjoys doing any work on smartphones. So desktop computers, in turn, have transformed into this professional tools. And mobile devices have become these tools for fun. But that's also contrary to how desktop computers were first marketed. You know, if you look at the way that Steve Jobs has been talking about the desktop computers and the Macintoshes and the PCs in the 80s and the 90s, for example, very much these were geared at creative applications. You know, they were like, everyone's going to have a computer in their home and everyone's going to be able to, like, publish and do these creative things and, you know, make pictures and videos and so on. So that was the intention from the beginning. For both desktop computing and for mobile computing, the initial intention and the eventual value creation engine seem to have switched around. This pattern, is there like a significant insight or a significant pattern here which applies to other places in computing and in design, in your opinion? Or is it just one isolated, interesting observation that we can make?
Yeah, I think that's, I think you just sort of made that clever analysis. I think that's very interesting.
But I want to get to some other topics, because I noticed that your work involves a lot of screen recordings, data collection on what people are doing with their smartphones. So you were doing these for research purposes, and perhaps the commercial applications or exploitations of these kinds of data collection approaches were not so popular at the time. Recently, they are extremely ubiquitous. They're everywhere. Every app that we use almost is collecting some form of data, especially the things we use for free. We are giving away our data in return for the services and experiences that are provided by certain apps. And our information captured without our knowledge is being commercialized and sold to profit, the people who make these applications. So how do you feel about these methods today compared to how you felt when you were implementing them in the past? And what do you do differently? What is different today about collecting data on people's phones, instrumenting software to record things on people's phones, that wasn't a consideration when you started doing this 20 years
Great
ago?
Great question. Yeah, I should first say that I have never had, like, the technical skills to do these things myself, really. And I think that was sort of a difference at the time, that there were people who were very interested in building technologies, and they were not so good at understanding, you know, like, what people were actually doing with the things. And then there were people who were very interested in understanding and studying these things, but they did not have the technological skills to get the type of data that they wanted. I was lucky enough to sort of find different types of collaborations and different, so that I can get these setups working. And there was sometimes very like hacking things in different ways and doing things to collect and record data. What was happening at that time was that you had to construct, and you were like, as a researcher, you were in control of what you would set up, what you would collect, because you had to like really like push your way into get this data. And then you could be very clear to the informants that were participating that, okay, this is the data that I'm collecting, because it was easy for me to have control of it. And what I would do then, we would organize it so that the people who we recorded, they would be in charge of the data. So they would have the data on their own phone, and then they would decide like when they would leave that to us. They would say, I'm happy, or like, I'm fine with giving you this data. And we would transfer it. So which meant that they could delete certain phone calls or, you know, certain messages before they would hand it over to us. Whereas when we're doing things now, there are many things that are very sort of integrated into apps and platforms that we're using. So it's much harder as a researcher, obviously as a user, it's very hard to sort of control, but also as a researcher, you don't have really the same opportunities to say that, okay, I'm interested in this and I don't want to have all this. To give you one example now, here at the university, we are building an app to collect and visualize step data. So how many steps you take each day. And it's a very sort of, that's very simple. You know, we want to have the data of your steps. We don't want to have all this other type of information. But it's quite difficult to do that because the steps are sort of a part of a larger health kit, you know, in the in the tools. So mm-hmm. we also, by sort of by accident or as a side thing, we get all this other data, like your sleep patterns, maybe your heart rate variability, all these things that could be interesting, but for our purposes, we just want to have the steps. And then what happens then is when we ask people to participate in our study, we don't want them to feel uncomfortable with sharing all this, you know, health data with us. Yeah. So we're trying to find ways now to sort of, you know, to unpack that. I think it's very complicated. And there was one time also in connection to doing the social media studies where like Facebook and Instagram were much more open as platforms. So we could scrape data and we could get data by ourselves, like over these platforms. Whereas now they are much more difficult to get. We can't really work through these. So in a way, it was both more difficult and simple before, I guess.
Yeah, those are interesting insights. So that's why I like to have these conversations with scholars like yourself, in addition to the presentation of your work, because these reveal the considerations behind what goes in there. I think these details, sometimes even in highly detailed research publications, some of these considerations might go undocumented. At least that's what I see when I sometimes look for these things, because sometimes when I'm doing my research, I have these questions about how do I deal with this challenge. For example, we were working with drones recently, and I wanted to do certain studies where a person gets in a room where a drone is flying and that there's certain tasks that they do and so on. And I asked around for, you know, what kind of precautions should I take? Is there a safety protocol? Is there a particular checklist that I have to observe in terms of the legal and practical and you know, other considerations that apply in this situation to ensure the safety of people, to ensure that, you know, I'm not liable. And there was very little actual protocol. So I had to go and look at like 20, 30 different papers to do that. But to have you here responding to questions like this is tremendously valuable because of that. I want to get back a little bit to the topic of research methods, because you have mentioned that you prefer field studies and in the wild studies, going out in the snow and going out with these people rather than bringing them into the lab. And I agree with your sentiment. And the reason I agree with it is that I feel that it has higher, to use the technical terms, the scientific or academic terms, studies in the wild seem to have higher task validity.
where you, people are dealing with tasks that are already relevant to the situation that is being investigated, and they have higher ecological validity or external validity, which are distinguished from each other by nuances, I think. Would you agree with this particular characterization of why field studies are better than lab studies for investigating mobile computing topics? Or are there any other considerations for why you prefer the methods that you prefer?
I think you formulated it in a very nice way. It's all about finding sort of the situation where this type of activity would happen. As the example with the driving and the mobile phone use in the car, I think that's like a very telling example of how I can understand, like from a lab perspective, you want to be able to study, you want to be able to like compare different differences and like, okay, what if we do this type of interface? And what if, like, if we have a button here, what happens then? Let's test it 10 times and then we move the button to that side and then we test it 10 times. I mean, they're very comparable. So I understand that for certain research questions, you would be interested in using such an approach. Whereas then you would also have to have an understanding of, okay, so it doesn't matter if the button is there or there, if people have like so big gloves on so they can't even touch the button. So there's like a combination, of course. So I'm not saying that we should never do lab studies or these studies don't have any value. Obviously they have, but it depends on the questions you have, and you really have to combine methods. Many people are so strict with their own approach, they keep with that even if it's not really a relevant method for the questions that they have.
It was very on point that you brought up the car example, because I wanted to ask you, from all of your studies, so you've looked at a lot of topics which are all very relevant to certain real-world applications. So can you give a couple of concrete examples of how people outside of academia have learned from what you have published and what you have studied? So the learnings that you have uncovered, how have they informed the work of people outside of academia? Have there been any developers, engineers, designers who created application software or gadgets based on your learnings, or have they informed any policy making?
Yeah, I guess that's everyone's dream as a researcher, you know, to have some impact, not just in terms of like number of publications and stuff like that. Maybe not so much in design. I've been a part of different boards. I was on a group for seniors, like digital senior expert group for, started by Duro. There was a company that designed phones that were particularly targeting older users. And we had a lot of discussions based on the studies that I had done on the differences that older people were encountering. I think that that type of discussions that we had, and like me presenting real cases, because that's really, I think that's a very valuable thing to designers and to industry and policymakers, to really show examples of things. This is what happens in the real world. This is how messy things are. This is like beyond, you know, the sort of the nice design scenario that maybe you have when you are designing. This is beyond that. This is like the everyday fussy world and what's going on. Yeah, so I hope we have contributed. Like I said, we did a debate article about the study with the professional drivers, and I know a lot of people read that, and it was highly debated in Sweden at that time by some people working in that field. So I'm hoping that we have influenced in some way to make people look at what people are actually doing.
Yeah, your answer actually illustrates something very interesting, which is that what I observe as sort of, you know, casually, and what you uncover when you do rigorous research on a topic can be different things. So in my observation, for example, age and integration with the digital world, let's say, for the lack of a better word at this time, is quite correlated and inversely correlated. But in your research results, you're saying that the actual drivers, the actual factors that determine that sort of integration are different. But I want to get to a completely other topic, a completely other research project that you've done, where you looked at selfies in the wild. I've come to like consider the notion of selfies or the ideas of around selfies via being exposed to some entirely other resources recently. So recently I came into contact with the work of Lord Rabbi Jonathan Sacks. I think one of the most senior, or perhaps the most senior leaders of the Jewish faith in the United Kingdom. And he is also a PhD in philosophy. And he recently published a book where he argues that the self, the overemphasis of the self, appears to be the dominant trend of our age. And this is degrading, this is hurting social institutions and the ability of humankind and human societies to survive and thrive collectively. He looks at, for example, literature for the use of the word I and the word we. And he shows in data that when you look at the books that are published, when you look at what people are saying and writing, usage of the word I has been increasing and surpassing the usage of the word we in the recent sort of century or so. What do you think about the impact of selfies, which is a practice that you've studied, but also other related practices around social media and mobile computing, on the well-being of human societies rather than individuals?
That's a very big question for us to respond to. And I'm not sure my work completely has sort of that aim to answer those questions. So for one thing, we need to consider sort of social media has really given people a new way to sort of speak their voice. It's really a way to, you know, to reach out there and for people to be more, as in the case, for instance, with the perception of the woman, you know, like the women are presented in a certain way in media and in commercials and so on. And it's a very, very sort of specific way of, you know, portraying women. Whereas with social media, young women now have, you know, the opportunity to sort of own their own body and to present their own image in a way that they control. Of course, you can think of this as sort of superficial or narcissistic, you know, that it's often sort of portrayed in that way. But you can also think about it in terms of like empowerment, of giving people now a tool to sort of really own their own storytelling and their own sort of image. That can be influential on a societal level as well. You know, what happens when it's not just controlled, you know, from sort of from the top, that people are coming and doing other things.
I have a long-standing interest in economics, actually. I've even studied economics in my university years. And in economics, one of the central, most important concepts where everything is founded upon, in some sense, is the notion of trade-offs. So you gain one way and you lose another way. So every project, every act of human collaboration, for example, involves a trade-off between scale and coordination. So when you put more and more people together, the scale of what you can achieve grows, but also the cost of coordinating the efforts increases. With social media and practices around, you know, self-photography and so on, as you said, potential for diversity or a plurality of opinions and, you know, tolerance even increases perhaps, but that comes at other costs perhaps, which are detrimental to some other social structures. So there's always trade-offs involved in every technology and every decision that we make, I suppose. That actually was, so these were the questions that I noted while you were giving the presentation. And I have some, let's say, rapid fire questions that I want to ask you, because I like to ask these to all of our guests. And the first of these questions is, what skills, habits, behaviors, beliefs should a young person, perhaps imagine a student, who has 1 or 2 years to study, what should they cultivate in order to be productive and effective in contributing to the kinds of work that you're doing?
I would say like compassion and kindness. If you want to cultivate anything, that's where you should start. And then the curiosity to learn things and to sort of stay away from like prejudice, try to learn things and look at things with fresh new eyes.
Would you recommend any specific resources such as books or any exercises that we might use to cultivate those qualities?
Well, you're practicing yoga yourself, yoga and meditation and different breathing techniques and a lot of these things can sort of anchor us to the present moment in ways that will allow us to really, in our work and in all things we do. Like when we are reading a book, we should be reading a book. We should not be thinking about what we should cook for dinner or like a problem that we can't solve. And it's the same when we are meeting people that we want to design technologies for. We should really open ourselves to sort of their experience and be present in that moment. I think a lot of people have like an impatience in doing. I was very impatient when I was younger as well. I wanted to do so many things. So I'm trying now to not do as many things, but to be more focused in the things that I do. And that's sort of easy to say once you're a professor, I guess.
The way that I like to articulate that is to focus on the things that you can control, focus on the availabilities of things in the present moment and not like, don't worry about things that are impossible. So right now, for example, we have the pandemic and we can't meet each other in person in many ways. We can't hold events and so on. But that also enables certain things. Let's focus on those. Let's not focus on what we've lost and try to, you know, recreate those things in some way. But it's more efficient to focus on the possibilities that are enabled by limitations, actually, because each limitation enables us to focus on what's possible, and by focusing on those things, achievements or productivity is unlocked. That's how I like to put that. But it's very interesting that you bring up yoga in the same breath as compassion. I feel that also, and I spent a long time thinking about, you know, why do I feel more compassionate? Why do I become, in a way, a better person when I practice physical exercise? Not necessarily only yoga, but anything that increases my physical health and puts me in a closer sort of contact, a closer dialogue with my own physical sensations and my physical health. I found that a lot of disturbances, a lot of negative thoughts and feelings, which eventually lead to frictions between people, a lot of negativity, negative energy that we have actually stems from physical discomfort. We feel uncomfortable because, you know, some of us, our muscles are uncomfortable from sitting too long. Maybe we've eaten too much for breakfast. Maybe I have another sort of injury in my arm, which hurts me, and that's why I feel bad and so on. And when you understand this, when you understand how much of your negative feelings come from physical negativity, then you also understand that perhaps all the people around you, sometimes they respond to you negatively because of these things. So you start to distinguish, and that gives you compassion in my line of thinking. That's how it happened, at least.
So I can ask you a question then. How do you think that, or do you think that technology could help us with such an awareness?
At the moment, I feel like it's doing the opposite. At least when I look at in my life from, let's say, an auto-ethnographic perspective, I feel that most of the technology that I have in my life is detrimental. And when I involve myself in these physical practices, when I go to the yoga studio, for example, I make a point of leaving all technology, of leaving my tablet or my phone. I leave it outside of the room. I don't bring it in. And those are the practices I find that give me physical health and physical well-being. I read this in an academic paper, actually. I read this in a design HCI paper where someone was saying that well-being is about engagement with the present world, the present state of the world, what is happening right now in front of you. It's about engagement with one particular thing. And if you have a phone which allows you to simultaneously engage with an infinite number of things as you're sitting somewhere, that's actually detrimental to health in many ways. So I'm also myself exploring some of these questions in my research, and I hope to come up with better answers in time. Because I think the approaches that I've tried so far, which have been things like sensing the human body, detecting human motions, using these to control computers, these I think haven't given me the results I've been aiming for. But I do have a vision for the future where I think there are two ideas. One of them is a technological idea and the other is a philosophical idea within our field, which have great potential to addressing this issue. The technological idea that I'm fond of is personal robotics, where the computing artifacts around us, these are moving things that sometimes, maybe they're flying around, maybe they're part of a drone, maybe it's a robot that moves around my house and does things and so on. I think in robotics and actuation of the real world with computing artifacts is one possible solution to this problem. The other is philosophical. And that's a recent idea that I've heard articulated in design and computer science called entanglement, which comes from like post-humanist perspective. This is perhaps paradoxical. Perhaps it sounds like the complete opposite of what we're talking about. But I feel like, for example, when you're designing a jacket, which humans also put things inside of, you know, we have pockets in our jackets, we put our phones and wallets and things in there. If we design with not only the human anatomy in mind, but also with the form of the devices in mind, or when we're designing a workspace, a desk, when we keep in mind the forms and actions and movements and life cycles of the devices that will occupy that desk, I think those ideas have the potential to improve the human physical condition. While the human is interacting with these technologies. Two more final questions. Have you experienced a failure or apparent failure in your career, which later set you up for success? Do you have, for example, a favorite failure?
When we did the study of Instagram and published that, we had some press coverage on that. And it sort of... it just took off and it got circulated quite broadly. And this was like in 2012 or 13 or something. Our research was taken up in a big science blog in the US. And they wrote something about our study. And the title for this was, "Did you seriously get funding to study this? It was the title. And they were, because they thought that social media, you know, was a very superficial sort of unscientific, very, you know, not the relevant thing to look at. And like we were looking at like Instagram pictures and selfies and lunch photos and so on. And they just didn't think that was fun. And we were a bit sort of shocked. You know, first we were like, oh, we're in this blog. And then I was like, oh, no. And they were actually quite, I mean, I think it was quite amusing. They wrote it in a quite funny way. They were also maybe very hard. And it was one of our PhD students that was also involved in this. And she was quite new. And for her, it wasn't very nice to hear these things. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. But then we took that and we sort of turned it. So when we presented the Kai paper on this study, we would just start, you know, with the opening, you know, of the did you seriously get funding to study this? That, you know, gave us even more attention. It's like, even if you get the mention like that, it's still, I mean, that helps you to spread your research. And so it can be a good thing in the end, even if people write.
Yeah, of course. I tend to believe that the best ideas, the most interesting ideas, the inventions are things that are uncategorizable. People, when they first see this thing, they can't fit it into a box. So they say, oh, it doesn't fit into the box, so it must be bad.
Yeah.
But it's just something new.
Yeah, definitely.
I remember, for example, I'm as you know, I'm interested in you know, entrepreneurship and leadership and institutions, and I've studied how some of the institutions that in that are relevant to our field, for example, to design and technology, have been founded and taken shape over the years. I remember listening to a talk by Professor Negroponte, who was one of the founders of the MIT Media Lab, and he mentions how when he wanted to start the MIT Media Lab, he was turned away by his colleagues who said, this is not computer science. What you're doing is not research. You're just sort of, you know, making toys or whatever is what they said. But right now, as we all know, that institution is one of the premier arenas for the kind of work that is relevant to what we're working with. So before I conclude, I want to ask you a final question, which is, what is a question that I should be asking you or should have asked you, but neglected? Is there perhaps a question that only you and you alone in this world can answer?
I don't think I have that sort of, I don't see myself in that way. No, well, you didn't ask the question actually that you asked a lot of other of your, the people you interviewed about who's your role model.
Yes. Yeah, that's a good point. Thank you.
But besides that, I don't think there's anything. I'm glad you didn't ask me too much about the future because, like, knows about the future.
Then do you have any particular people or projects that you look up to these days that inspire you and inspire your work?
Like, what inspires me now is, I think it's like, I want to borrow things from other disciplines and from other domains. So so psychology is like a discipline that I'm looking into now to see what people are up to there in terms of studying smartphones. And I know there's a lot of talk there about addiction. They also tend to use more experimental methods. And I don't always agree on the way that the studies are being done, but I think there is an sort of enormous potential in combining our approaches. Mm-hmm. So I really want to collaborate more with people in that domain. And there are people there who sort of have that approach that they want to also look out a bit. There's a new book out by David Ellis, who's a psychologist who's been studying smartphones in a bit new ways and challenging, you know, the notions of things as screen time and how we can study these things.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Weilenmann. Thank you for all the wisdom. That was certainly very, very relevant for myself as well as my students. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you for a really good question and really you have very good analysis of many, many things. So you should continue working on that.
Thanks. I'll try to live up to that.